our first beer is from Rise Brewing in Minneapolis. It is a pale ale. You're going to hate this one, Laura. It's a pale ale made with citra hops called Course Correct. The reason I chose this to go with this first poem is that this first poem is kind of a, it, as I read it, is kind of a reflection on life's journey and the many opportunities to course correct, to change course, to think about, you know, this is what I was doing then, and then I changed, and this is, these, I got in these relationships, and then I changed. So I just thought the name of the beer was appropriate for this poem, Course Correct. So, Laura, you're not going to drink that out of the can, are you?
Oh, goodness, no. More class than that. So, since you promised me I'm going to hate it, I only poured a little bit.
All right, cheers.
We'll see, yeah. Yeah, it's not my favorite.
Yeah, didn't think it would be. You don't like the hops.
It was really neat to just see the outpouring of love for him, and I found his obituary online, and all these people from all poetry were there leaving comments. So it's a really neat place to connect with other poets and make friends. So one of my questions had actually been for you to define a glose. Is it pronounced glose? I think you said
glose, G-L-O-S-E.
And you did that before I even asked, but do you know the history of this form?
I do not. That's something you can Google. I don't always write down what country the form originates in, but usually when I publish, I'll put the form of poem, but I don't, you know, I don't tell you anything about how to write it or where it originates. But if you would like to study it or do one yourself, you can Google it. And one of my favorite editors is Robert Lee Brewster, B-R-E-W-S-T-E-R. He has a wealth of information on poetic forms. If you just
I did look up the various forms that you listed, and see, I didn't write it down in my notes. I have a terrible short-term memory, like early write down, what did you do this month? I don't know, it's been a busy month. I might forget if I don't write it down. But I think the glose is the one that is medieval Spanish form. So, but I'm going by memory. It's possible it's one of the others, but I think it is.
That sounds about right. Yeah.
Okay. I found that really interesting that even that long ago, they were, you know, creating so many different forms, and they were doing this idea of borrowing, except really it shouldn't surprise me. I mean, you're also a musician. So, you know, a lot of times it seems to go together, music and poetry. And in
right.
music, there was a similar thing that back in medieval times, nobody thought anything of taking somebody else's melody and they use it as their baseline and build a new melody over it.
Right.
You know, we would go like, oh my gosh, that's plagiarism. You know, you're stealing someone else's work. But to them, it was just how it's done.
That's always done. And I know in music, a lot of times that the performers will borrow, you know, something and use some lines from another famous song. So, you know, there are just all sorts of things that I enjoy. And I just had it before I talked to you guys, I just had a inspiration for a new song. So wish me luck and hope that it works out and I can get it maybe some play and some attention.
I was curious with this form, you know, do you start with an idea of what you want to say and then you go find, say, Emily Dickinson's poem that will work, or do you pick a poem you like and then
I just think of, you know, something that I would like to work with. Sometimes I'll just go on a site and find famous poems or Google, say, poems about death or poems about friendship and just go through that. You know, there's sites with like 100 famous poets or something like that. So it usually works out pretty well. I just pick something that I like and zero in on a verse that I think it would be, you know, the verse or the lines that I like to recreate into something new, and I just go from there.
And you work in a lot of forms. You know, as I looked at some of your various interviews or writings or bios online, you work with quite a lot of historical forms and forms around the world. And I'd say today, freeform is kind of much more popular. What is it that appeals to you about working in forms specifically?
Just more creativity, just expanding my craft and getting those 530 poems. I actually have more than 530. I have some lost poems. We talk about the lost years, and the apocrypha has been lost for some time and discovery. But I have some other poems that I started off with. Was an earlier publisher, and that went back to Thailand and published me. And not all of those are immortalized online. I started with Kevin Watts Community and All Poetry a few years ago. And so that's what I have really amassed in the last years. But I have maybe 100 poems that I have not immortalized online because I don't have them anymore. They're in the library at my schools, but I didn't catalog them for online. But you know, it's okay. I have enough online.
As I think about your question, Laura, it's like for me, imposing a structure helps my creativity.
You know, I find that
it gives me boundaries, gives me limits that I have to find ways to work within.
Right.
I find it really interesting that both of you say that. And I think so too. I love working in forms, but I think a lot of people today feel the opposite, that they're being constricted in a box and they feel it hinders their creativity. But one of the things that I read years ago about the early poets working in free form was that the reason they were so good at it was exactly because they had spent so much time working within boundaries, within rules, that they really had to find ways to deal with so many things. They had to find creative vocabulary, images, they had to think about rhythm and flow and all these things. So I think those early poets of free form would agree with you, but I think a lot of people don't see that today.
Well, yeah, I do free form. I do all sorts of poems. You know, some of them may not be as mature to the critics as others, but I have over 100 solid poem forms, and there's more than that. So some of them I couldn't figure out very readily. They were more challenging, but you know, Brewster lists about 168. That's the most I found. There may be more, but Brewster research, like that. Yeah. And I have at least 100. So I'm well on the way.
Interesting and really challenging. But no, I agree too that free form absolutely can be done very well. I wish that people would work both ways, you know, because both have their benefits, but I think forms are not as highly regarded today as maybe I think they should be. one last question, unless I mixed up the many things I was reading, you were published when you were 11 in anthology. How in the world did that come to happen?
Through the mail. I don't know how. I got a lot of great opportunities in the mail. Now they're coming through email, and I'm just kind of networking with great people like you guys. And they give me ideas and workshops and markets where my poetry can be heard, and magazine editors that might like to, get some work submitted for anthology. So, but this just came in the postal mail way back when, and they just asked me to, I don't know why they picked me, but they just asked me to contribute. So I just had a little childlike poem and they picked it and they put my picture in and my little biography next to you and your colleagues. And I guess I was the youngest person there. I looked like a little pygmy and I didn't even look 11. I looked like a little 6-year-old. I was so small.